Someone representing Pastors Noel and Shawnee Centino. They are not with us today, but they'll come back. Don't you worry. Okay? They're just out there having to do with the things that they have to do with their clan. And Pastor is the one heading the whole clan. I'm not pretty sure as to how they... but they have to take care of some things as well. But anyways... He said he would like to have last Saturday and the whole services today to be to have the emphasis on the youth. So that's the reason why I stand here in front of you. But I'm just thankful to the Lord for giving us such an opportunity to speak to you regarding our the next generation or the youth, the generation of the youth. When I first came to Cruisers, I was a bit shocked, or more appropriately, I would say I was a bit culture shocked. Because when I came there, I was working at a secular job, but then when I, Pastor Shawnee said, you go to Cruisers, and then I went and then be there with them, and they were like, "Ooh, come on, people, come on," and I said, what on earth is happening here? Because I was used to being serious, and I still am a little bit serious. But later on, I realized that these people are wonderful people. Amen? Do you see any youth there? These are wonderful people that we have here. And we're so proud of what God is doing in their lives. But there's something about the youth. They want to have... they like to shortcut things. For example, with the words that they use, instead of saying di mada, they say DMD. Mm-hmm. They like to say LSS instead of saying last song syndrome. And they have a lot of ways of cutting in sentences and words, making those words, making those sentences sound youthful. And the thing there is, it sounds youthful, we just don't understand what it is that they're saying. But same thing is true. They're still loved of God. Amen? And these people are very important to God, just like you and me. I have to admit that I am no longer a youth. Praise God. Anyways, one time I went with my brother, and we went. We were trying to get into a place because we would like to be with the family, just the four of us, my mom, my dad, as well as my brother and myself, because we would just like to spend some time with each other. And I was in the car, and my brother was with me, and I was kind of singing some songs, this song, and he just said to me, "Ate, uncle, what? Your song is lame." What did you say? Your song is lame. L-A-M-E. Lame. What on earth are you saying? Let me listen to what you are listening. He was trying to plug. He was having his earphones plug into his ears. Amazingly, he could hear me still singing. But then he plugged in those earphones, and he was listening to his own music. And I got his earphones plugging into my own ears. And then the first thing I ever heard, and I was so shocked, was that this person was not just singing, not singing actually. He was screaming at the top of his voice. Oh, amazing. This is not a song. This is not a music. This is noise. And then he was looking at me, and he was smiling, and he said, "That's music." Amazing. Amazing miming. Anyways, so the youth are different, they're unique, I should say, but they are wonderful people. Another thing about them is they are very curious. They would like to check on something. And they just would like to try anything for the sake of trying it. Not really necessarily because someone told them to do it, but they just would like to try it. And because of this curiosity, if it's not being led to the right direction, what happens is that they make wrong decisions. And we don't want our youth to make wrong decisions. Can you say amen to that? Amen. And just like the statistics, we've asked one of our youth workers to help us with the research. She's here. Thank you, Luther. And it says in this statistics, it says a total of 215 Filipino youth aged 15 to 24 years old were recorded as HIV positive in the first quarter of the year. In March alone, 82 cases of HIV in the same age bracket were recorded by the Department of Health. This is from Inquirer Research. So with the influence of media, with the influence of the internet, we have a fight to fight for our youth. Amen. We don't want our youth to be wayward. We want them to be a people who love God, who honor Him. It doesn't matter about what music that they are listening to, as long as that music pleases God. It doesn't matter as to what beat their dances are, but then what matters is the heart of what they're doing, right? And so, Pastor would like us to understand from the Bible, from God Himself, as to how we, our generation, can impact their generation. How we can positively affect them so that they grow into people that are good citizens of this country. Imagine Philippines, 20 or 30 years from now, and we have done our part as the people of God. Imagine Philippines. It would be such a glorious, glorious country. We would have better engineers. We would have teachers who love God and who serve people. We would have architects. We would have business people who are honest because they fear God. We would have people, wonderful citizens of the Philippines, and Philippines would be a better nation. Amen. That's the goal. That's the thing that, that's the heartbeat of the whole thing this morning. And before we do that, can we just lift up our Bibles today? Before we dive in into the Word of God, can you just lift your Bibles with me? Pastor always does this, so let's just do this. Okay. Let's do this. Okay, say it with me. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I can do what it says I can do. Today I'm going to be taught of the Word of God. My heart is willing. I am receptive. I am willing and obedient. I am blessed and cannot be cursed. And everyone says, amen. 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 And the text for the whole time today is about 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy 1 verse 5. Can you please open your Bibles there? 2 Timothy 1 verse 5. If you have the verse, if you found a verse, just say, found it. Okay. We'll wait for the other people. 2 Timothy 1 verse 5. Found a verse? Okay, let's just read it all together. Go. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother, Lois, and your mother, Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well. Let's just pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you. You are the author, Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. We thank you, Father, because every day you're just bringing us into a deeper level of our knowledge with you, deeper level of our relationship with you. And Father, you're not just after us. You are after the generation after us. We thank you, Lord, that you are going to teach us today of your word. And we thank you for the Holy Spirit, the greatest teacher who is amongst us, and he will teach us today your word. Our hearts are open for you, God, and we thank you that your name will be blessed and your name will be glorified in our midst, and we will only give the glory to you, for we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Three things that we're going to be talking today are the following. Number one, which are basically in the verse itself, it says, I am reminded of your sincere faith. The second one would be a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Louis and your mother Eunice. The third one, which would be, I am sure dwells in you as well. Let's start with the first one. I am reminded of your sincere faith. Can you say that with me? Sincere. When we talk about sincerity or being sincere, that has something to do with it being genuine. It's the kind of faith that has been tested through fire and it has been found to be pure. It has been found to be true. It has been found to be genuine. The Bible says in Hebrews 11 verse 1 that faith is the substance. Can you say that with me? The substance. The substance of things hoped for. And the evidence of things seen. In the world, people would say, to see is to believe. But with God, it's quite different. He says, believe, and then you'll see. Believe, and then you'll perceive. Believe, and you'll understand. Sometimes, in Hebrews 11, you'll see there this list of wonderful people. There's a list of people who have been faithful to God. It's like a hall of faith. You'll see Abraham there. What happened to Abraham? Abraham was called of God, and he said to Abraham, Abraham. His name was Abram, but then he was changed, and it had become Abraham, the father of many nations. He said, Abraham, I would like you to leave your father's household. I would like you to leave your country and go to the place that I will be showing you. And Abraham, even though he didn't understand, he didn't really know as to where exactly he should go, he believed, stepped out in faith, packed up all his bags, and then brought with him his family, Lot with him as well, and he went to the place where God would like him to be. Faith, substance of the things unseen. The same thing happened with Sarai. Sarai was not young enough to have a child. She was actually very old enough. Now, very old that she would never be able to have a child in the natural realm. But see, because of faith, when God told her, you will actually have a child, she believed. And what happened was that? Came Isaac. Faith. There was also this man known as Noah. Noah built an ark. It was such a summertime, and to be exact, there was no rain. And God told him, Noah, I would like you to build an ark. Never questioned God, just did it the way God would like it to be. And then the people laughed at him, the people persecuted him. You are crazy, Noah. Why are you building an ark? And he told them about what God was trying to tell the people, and the people did not listen to him, but he still continued on, believing on what God says. And of course, long story short, we know that there came rain, a lot of rain, and then the flood came. Because of faith, Noah and his family were kept safe, but those who did not believe, they died. For the application, for example, in our time, say, I don't know what you're going through in life. Say you are going through tough times. And instead of saying, Lord, I'm not going to be able to make it. It's just so impossible. You say, God, you said in your word that I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. You said in your word, God, that if I cast my burdens upon you, you will sustain me. You said in your word, Lord, that as I follow you, I shall be the head and not the tail, God. Because you see, we may see the bad reports. We may see the gamay na lang a kwarta. But the truth of the matter is, the truth is bigger than the facts. Our situations can change when the supernatural changes the situation. Do we believe that nothing is impossible with God? That He will do whatever He says and He will do. Faith, even though nothing's happening yet with the situation, you're believing God to do something. For example, you feel so sad in the inside of you. Who amongst us know that emotions cannot be the means of deciding on things because emotions change, right? For example, you feel so sad in the inside of you, something happened to you throughout the week, and when you came to your house, you had a fight with your husband or your spouse, and then you said, man, my week had been so down, I'm so down in the inside of me. Instead of speaking bad things, you say, God, you said in your word that your kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. I may not be feeling good right now, but I believe that joy is in the inside of me. Faith, brothers and sisters. Because what we are is what God says who we are. It's not our emotions. Amen? If you are sick, well, the Bible says that you are made whole already. By the stripes of Jesus, you have been made whole. Whole. If you have a kid or a son or a daughter who has been wayward, you say, God, you promise in your word. You said, Father, that if I believe in you, I shall be saved and my whole family. I claim your word over my son. I claim your word over my daughters, God. They shall be you. They shall serve you. They shall love you. Now I speak forth your word to them, Lord God. They'll listen in the name of Jesus. Faith. Can you say to the person beside you, faith? In Hebrews 11 verse 6, you would see that without faith, it's impossible to please God. Because you see, it's not fear that moves God. It's faith. In the Bible, you would see Jesus healing people. And he would say, your faith has healed you. Your faith has healed you. Your faith has healed you. So without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's very important. Faith is very important in our lives. Amen. And God has given that faith into us. In Romans chapter 12, verse 3, it says, for I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. Every one of us has been given of God a measure of faith. Some may be little, but the truth of the matter is our faith can grow. Our faith can grow. Amen. You come to the house of God, you sought Him first today. We believe that because you have sought Him today first, that He's going to add things to you that you need. God says in His word that if you seek Him first in your life, you sought Him first by coming here. We appreciate you by doing that. And you are actually doing yourself a favor. God says He's going to add to you things that you need in the desires of your heart. Can everyone say amen to that? And when we come to the house of God, we are taught of the word of the Lord. And every time we hear the word of God, we grow. Every time we go to the Bible study, we grow. Every time we have our devotional, we have our QT or quiet time with the Lord, we grow. Every time we come in contact with this supernatural God, we grow. Every time we hear the word of God, Romans 10, 17 says, so then faith comes by hearing. Can everyone say that? By faith, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Every time you come to the house of God, you're growing. Every time you join a Bible study, you're growing. Every time you listen to God, every time you hear the sermon, you're growing. We're growing in Jesus' name. And Paul is saying here to Timothy, Timothy, my son. Son, because he is actually his son in the faith. Paul was telling him, Timothy, amazing, amazing, amazing. Amazing. The faith that I remember that you have, that faith is so sincere. Now let's perhaps go back a little bit as to who Timothy was, shall we? Let's go to Acts chapter 16, verses 1 through 4, please. Acts chapter 16, verses 1 to 4. If you have the verse, just say, I'm ready. Would like to know who Timothy was and how and what were the things that had happened to him. You have the verses, say I'm ready. Okay. In Acts 16 verses 1 to 4 it says he came, Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra where a disciple named Timothy lived. So Timothy lived in that vicinity. Derbe and Lystra are places in Asia Minor whose mother was a Jewess and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. In the Bible, there's not much mentioning regarding the father. Probably the dad is dead. So the mother had been raising Timothy on her own, a widow. And then it says, where am I? Then it says, the brothers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him. Paul wanted to take him along on the journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. Verse 4, as they traveled from town to town, they delivered the decisions reached by the apostles and the elders in Jerusalem for the people to obey. Who was Timothy? Timothy was the son of Eunice, a Jewess and a believer as well. And he was the grandson of Eunice. Lewis is the grandmother. And it's so amazing to see right here in these verses that he, as a young man, had been recommended by the brothers, by the Christians themselves to Paul. You know Paul, right? Paul was a great apostle. He was used of God to go to the Gentiles and preach the word to them, to us. In the Bible, we see two people there, the Jews and the Gentiles. If you are not Jew by birth or by blood, you are a Gentile. You and me are Gentiles. But then Paul was sent to these people to preach the words to them. And you, if you be Timothy, as young as you are, you be recommended to this big person, Paul. That's an awesome thing, right? That's an awesome thing. You would also see there how well he was brought up by his parents. And then he had a good reputation. Scholar would say that he was a young man during that time. And Paul brought him with him to his journeys. He went to Ephesus, Thessalonica, etc. He actually worked with Silas as well. And when Timothy had proven himself to be true, Paul sent him out on his own. Okay, Timothy, you're fine now. Okay, you go. He trained him, and he was able to train him well. And then when he was okay, Timothy, go. Separate. No. Go and do the work of the Lord this time on your own. And if we know Paul, we know that Paul was one of those Christians in the Bible that had experienced a lot of persecutions, right? He was flogged. He was persecuted, stoned. What else happened to him? he experienced shipwrecked. Now, if you are with Paul, what do you think would happen to you? Do you think life would be easier for you? Do you think you would be happy and experiencing all those things? What do you think? Well, let me say this. If you're with Paul, you would experience the same things that he experienced, right? If he was stoned, you'll be stoned. Because the stone actually would not say, "Oy, dili man si Paul, dili ko pikas." Or, "Si Paul man ni, siya lang akong batuon. Kani pikas, no." So, Timothy's faith. The reason why Paul said, "Timothy, your faith is amazing. It's so sincere." Because he saw what Timothy had been through. Because Timothy was with him. But then even through trials, even through persecutions, people disowning them, people laughing at them, he stayed where God would like him to be. And I hope and pray we can be like that as well. And we have the possibility of becoming like that because God is able to faithfully finish what he has started in our lives. Amen? Amen. So, in Hebrews 13, verse 23, you would see here that at one point, Timothy was actually in prison. In Hebrews 13:23, it says, "I want you to know, brothers, that our brother Timothy has been released," meaning to say he had been in prison, "has been released." So through trials, through pain, through persecutions and joys, Timothy was there. That was the reason why Paul said, "I remember the faith that you have." That sincere faith that you have. Let's go to the phrase number two. 2 Timothy 1 verse 5. And it says, "A faith that dwelt in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice." We can see three generations here. The grandma, the Lola, going to the faith that she has. Or she had been taught, been given, or passed on to Lois. And Lois was able to pass on the faith that she had to Timothy. Now, Paul often talks about, in the Bible, Paul often talks about us being runners. Can you say to the person beside you, "You are a runner"? Say it with attitude, "You are a runner, baby." Anyways, we are all runners in the Bible, and when we dig deeper into the Word of God, we find that this is not just a mere marathon. This is basically a relay, a team relay, a relay race. In a relay race or a team relay, a runner holds and runs with him, carries with him a baton. I'm sorry, I don't have the original baton. I only have a tissue because this is the only thing I found here. There. But anyways, just take a look at this and just consider this graciously as a baton. A runner would run carrying the baton with him, and then in a relay race, what happens is that he passes on the baton to another person. That other runner runs and then gives out the baton to the next and then to the next and then to the finish line. How many of us here know that that's a picture of a Christian life? You know, leaders teaching other leaders, mentoring other leaders so that they can walk in the footsteps of the Lord in whatever God would like them to do. Parents teaching their kids, passing on the baton of faith to them. Preachers, pastors, teaching the congregation, passing on the baton of faith to them. That's a picture of a Christian life. Then we are all runners, and we are not alone in that run. Because you see, it's not just about you and me. It's about the people running with us. Amen. A great person is a person who can take care of himself. But greater is a person who takes care of himself and who helps other people to win. Amen. We are all runners according to the Bible. And that's a team relay. We find this in the scriptures. All over the scriptures. It's a painting of this whole story. A person passing on a baton of faith. We will see in the Bible, for example, Moses and Joshua. One day, the Lord said to Joshua, "Don't. Moses, your mother, master, is dead. Now I want you to be the leader of the Israelites." So from Moses, the baton of faith had been passed on to who? To whom? Joshua. Another example is found, of course, in the life of Timothy, from his Lola, Lois, to his mother, Eunice, and then to him. Parents passing on the baton of faith to their kids, passing on the baton of faith to their youth, to the generation after them. You would also see this in Mark chapter 3, verses 13 to 19. Also in Mark chapter 6, verses 7 to 13. I'm not going to read the verses. But this is the Lord Jesus Christ here. What he's doing is that he is handpicking. He had chosen for himself the apostles to be with him. You'll find it there that he chose apostles to be with him. And so that they would be able to see how he lived his life. He lives his life. They'd be able to see how he takes care of people, how he preaches, how he does ministry. That they will be able to see how he loves people and how he loves people to be saved. And then when they are ready, the Bible says, they will be sent out to preach. See, they will be, they would have the baton passed on them so that they do the job that the Lord has given to them. In the Great Commission, Matthew 28, 19 to 20, if you've memorized the verses, say it out loud with me. Matthew 28, 19 to 20 says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations." Make disciples of all the nations. Make disciples of all the nations. Pass on the baton of faith to all the nations. Pass on the baton of faith to people. Brothers and sisters, this is what we are called for. It's not about us only. It's the generation after us. It's the youth after us. Amen. We see that in the scripture. People passing on the baton of faith to people. So we may ask the question, whose responsibility is it then to pass on the baton of faith? Is it my responsibility, or is just the pastor's responsibility, or it may be just the parents' responsibility, and I'm single, so don't care, whatever. We'll talk about that for a moment. And let's go read open our Bibles in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 to 7 today. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 to 7. And if you have the verses, say amen. Very good. Let's just read this. It says in verse 6, "These commandments that I give you today are to be on your heart." Where should the commandments of God be? Unto our hearts. I somehow asked myself as to why God would like us to have his commandments on our hearts. Why not just have his commandments on here? Or here. Or maybe on the face, you know? Commandments on my face, Lord. Face. But he said, "Have my commandments on your heart." Proverbs says that your heart, you should guard your heart because it is the wellspring of life. In NLT, it says your heart should be, you guard your heart because it determines the course of your life. What fills your heart is what comes out of you in your speech. If your heart is good, what comes out of you is good. If your heart is problematic, because you had a problem with your boss. If your heart is angry because you had a fight with your spouse. If your heart is disappointed because a friend left you or a boyfriend left you. What comes out of you naturally are bad things, right? A tree produces its own kind, its own fruit. So, but if God's word is that which fills our heart, what comes out of us in our actions and in our words are good things. Amen. So God says here, yo, you have my commands in your heart, okay? Impress them on your kids. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and you're watching TV. Try to tell your child or your youth, kissing scene. Explain to him what the Bible says regarding that. When you go to the grocery, explain to him the value of money according to the Bible. When you do laundry, you explain to him or to her the value of hard work. Okay, kuso anak, kuso. The Bible said, talk to them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Parents' role is very important. Now, I am not trying to pretend to know what a parent feels, because honestly and obviously, I am not a parent. But you see, I am a daughter. And I know how it feels to be a daughter of a mother who loves God. I am what I am today because of the grace of God, yes, but God used people in my life so that I could become what I am today. Now, I have seen my mother pray. I have seen my mother every day in her life sitting down with her Bible, meditating on it, reading it. That's the example that I have seen. So I may not be a parent and I cannot relate with you as a parent, but I can sure say to you that your role as a parent is very important. Because you're going to affect your kids. In the youth ministry, we find that those youth who are very depressed, we call those emo type. Emo. We try to research the background, and we often see that the problem is with the family. Those youth who just, you know, a little bit of word and then just blows. These youth are, I'm not putting them down, but I'm just trying to say that they're like that because of a family that's dysfunctional. And that's a sad story. So you see, you as parents, how many are parents here? Just raise your hand, please. You have a big role to play in your kid's life. Now, you alone can fulfill that role. And your kids, your youth need you. And everyone who is a parent and who is willing to help the youth, say amen. So education starts at home. Proverbs 22 verse 6. It says, train a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not turn from it. Train a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not turn from it. Number one, raise your kids in the ways of God from infancy. When you have a child, like a baby, like that there, and that there as well, do not leave them at home. Bring them to church. Expose them to the things of God at an early age. Bring them to King's Kids. We have wonderful King's Kids teachers in the house. Amen. Bring them to KK Church. Let them experience. Let them know how it is to worship God. I saw teacher Faye Kaganina dancing. God, I would never do that with the kids. But that's a gift, you know. So bring your kids to the house of God. Let them experience. Let them see firsthand how you worship God. Let them see firsthand how you pray. We learn how to pray by listening to people pray, right? We learn how to pray when we hear our parents, we hear our pastor pray. And if you have a youth with you, let me just tell you to please bring them to Cruisers. Bring them to Cruisers. But it's night, man. I'm having a hard time having them to Cruisers during the night than have them during the Sundays. We have Domingo Jam, 1:30. After the service, we will have, 1:30, we will have Domingo Jam. But support your youth. Make them feel what the Bible says. Let them experience God in their lives. Support them when they go for ministry. That's serving God. What would you like them to do? Serve God or be a wayward child? Be in Cruisers or be in a disco houses? I think being in Cruisers is way better, right? Support them that they would be able to know God. And I would just like to take this opportunity to also tell you that on Tuesday, this Tuesday, we are going to Toledo. And now, let me tell you frankly that pastor would not have us do something that's not going to benefit us. That's not going to benefit the kids. That's not going to benefit you. Because it's just hard work, you know. Doing the materials alone, we have the youth here, and we thank the Lord for them. Ganggang had been helping out the rest of the people, Atifre and Timothy and Chanel. The rest of them are helping out. Curl. And we thank the Lord for them. But it's such a tedious thing to prepare the material. So if this is not going to benefit you, we're not going to do it. Pastor wouldn't let us do it. But since pastor wants the youth to know, to experience God, to be deeper in the Lord, that's the reason why he has given, or he has chosen, or he had asked us to have a camp. So, at least today, I would like to appeal to the parents. If you have a youth, if you have youths with you, release them to the camp. Let God do his thing in his life. We cannot change your people. Promise. I cannot change your people. God can. And the Bible says that Paul, or Saul, met Jesus, encountered Jesus in the road to Damascus. And because of that one encounter, he was changed. Now, give your child something that could possibly be an encounter that he would have with the Lord. And from Saul, he was changed to Paul. From who your child is going to change to a better man, better citizen of this country. Amen. Yeah, give God a wonderful hand of praise. 1 Samuel 1, verse 27. Before I go there, we would just like to appreciate all the mothers and the parents who are helping us out with the camp, and for all of you who are buying our products and eating and paying for the products as well. And we appreciate Ate Teresa and all Ate Kathy, who's helping us out, helping her child as well. 1 Samuel 1 verse 27, it says, dedicate your child to the Lord. So one thing that parents could do, according to the Bible, is that you dedicate your children to God. Can you say that with me? Dedicate your child to God. You'll find that in the life of Hannah. She dedicated her son Samuel to the Lord. Jesus was dedicated to the temple, or to the Lord. And the other thing that you could do, actually we could do as people of God, it's found in 2 Corinthians 3, verses 2 to 3. And it says, you yourselves are our letter, written on our hearts, known and read by everybody. You show that you are a letter of Christ, the result of our ministry, written not with ink, but with the Spirit, of the living God. On the tablets of stone, on tablets of human hearts. You can raise your kids up in the ways of God from infancy. Dedicate them to the Lord. Very important thing that you set a good example to them. Can you say an amen to that? And you say to the person at your back, set a good example. Can you shout at the person at your side, set a good example? We cannot do that in Cruiser, so I was just thinking to try it here. But anyways, set a good example. If you say, son, it's not good to smoke, and you smoke, that's not a good example, right? If you say, son, it's not good to drink alcohol, just drink water or juice, and then you go there with your barkada, that's not a good example, right? Because these youth, these kids need to see a good example. And you are supposedly that example. We ought to be that example. Can I hear an amen to that? Yes. Matthew 28:19-20. So it's the parents' role to pass on the baton of faith. Now the thing is that before we go to Matthew 28:19-20, it's as well as the ministry gifts responsibility. Ephesians 4:11-13 says, so Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip. Can you say that with me? To equip his people for works of service. So these pastors, Pastor Noel, Pastor Rachel, and the rest of the pastors here are given by God to this house to equip the saints, to disciple, to pass on the baton of faith. Matthew 28:19-20, this now is not just the parents' role, it's not just the ministry gifts role, prophets, apostles, pastors, teachers, etc.'s role. This now comes on us. 28:19-20, it says, therefore make and go and make disciples of all the nations. That's you and me. Can you say to the person beside you, that's you. And me. When you come to the house of God and you perhaps have noticed some youth, can I see the hands of all the youth here? Come on, wave your hands up high. Good. Okay. When you see the youth here and you see that they look so minghoy, they look problematic, they look brokenhearted, they look like the whole world is on their shoulders because they lost a pen or a cell phone. Go to them. Hug them. Make them feel at home. Because not all people, this is a sad thing, but it's true that not all people have wonderful family. And it's not the kid's problem. It's not the kid's, rather, fault. But we thank God that when we receive Christ in our hearts, what he does is this. He gives you mothers. he gives you daughters. He gives you sons. He gives you siblings. That's who we are, church. So when you see someone who's a youth, perhaps, because I'm in the youth ministry. I'm sorry for all the oldies, but you see a youth and that person seems to be having some problems, please go to that person. You don't know how a hug can change something. Because when you hug a person, that shows that it's going to be okay. You are making the person feel that, hey, I'm here. Plus, God is here with us. It's going to be okay. Man? Make them feel at home. Make them feel that whatever is going on with their family, we still have a family here. And whatever is going on with our parents, they are not perfect, just like us children who are not perfect. We have a perfect Father in heaven. Amen. Can we give God a wonderful hand of praise? We have a perfect Father who cares for us, who loves us dearly, and who takes care of all of us. So it's not just the parents' responsibility, not just the pastor's responsibility. It's our responsibility. It's actually each of one's responsibility. So Paul said, Timothy, I remember your faith, your sincere faith. And I know that that faith actually lived in your grandmom. And it lived in your mother's heart. And now I am sure. Can you say that with me? I'm sure. lives in you. I'm sure lives in you. I'm sure lives in you. Now, there's something about a relay race. I still have time. It's not just about your feet. You know, you could run. It's not just about that. The race actually hinges at the exchange zone. There's a designated area for you to be able to hand on or pass on the baton. If you passed on the baton wrongly, or even if you dropped the baton, if it's outside a designated area, that could disqualify the team. So it needs strong leaders. It needs strong disciple makers. We need strong parents to be able to know how and when appropriately would you have the baton of faith be passed on to the next generation. Because if you have passed it on without the right timing, that baton may be dropped. And you'll have to do it again. In our Christian life, you cannot just pass on the baton to a new generation without that generation experiencing the love of God first. Youth, let me see your hands again. Raise your hands up. Youth. Katong heart youth. Sorry, I'm talking about the youth only. Okay. I meant that gently and with all grace. You may put, they put their hands already. Okay, put down their hands already. There's something about the youth of today. They do not like discomfort. You pass on the baton of faith to them, they would say, I don't like the color of that baton, Sister Sweet. I don't like to do this. I don't like to do that. I do not want to go to the Bible study and be there. It's night. I will still have my bed rest, beauty rest. They do not want it. They don't want discomfort. They just want the spotlight. I want you to hand a baton right now. I can do that. But you see, we need people who are strong, who know how to handle the baton of faith or pass on the baton of faith. And we also need strong recipients of that baton of faith. Because your gift that you have in the inside of you can possibly destroy you if your character cannot sustain that gift. Amen. The Bible says in Proverbs that the gift actually opens the door for us. But it's your character that will make you stay there. You cannot just pass on the baton of faith to a generation and then the heads bloat. The Bible declares that pride comes before destruction. You cannot just hand on the baton of faith and their faith has not been tested. In 1 Peter, it says that the faith has to be tested to see if it's pure, to see if it's genuine, to see if it's like gold, pure. So it does not just need wonderful leaders, strong enough, have the wisdom of God in them to know when exactly to pass the baton. It also needs the youth to be strong enough to handle the responsibility with that baton of faith. 2 Timothy. I'm sorry, 1 Timothy 4, verse 12. It says, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. Who amongst you are youth again? Wave your hand, people. Come on. Wave. The Bible tells you, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. Can you say to the person, everyone of us here, can you say to the person beside you, don't let anyone look down on you? Because you are young. But God says here, you ought to be an example to the believers in love, in how the way you love people, in the way you love people, in the way you speak forth, that they find life there, not death. In speech, in love, in faith, that even if you are young, you stick with God, and by His grace you are able to do things. And in purity. The youth of today, because of the things that media offer, are having a difficulty with being pure sexually. And I think it's not just a problem of the youth, it's also a problem with the older generation. But then God is saying here, be an example in speech, in love, in faith, and in purity. Now let me just end this by going to Judges chapter 6. This is going to be the last one. So Paul was saying to Timothy, or perhaps to all of us today, he's saying, I remember the faith that you have. It's sincere. That faith which lived first in your grandmom, Lois, and then to your mother, Eunice, and then to you. I am persuaded that it's in you as well. Judges chapter 2, verses 6 to 15. This is probably a sad story. And we hope and pray that this is not going to happen to the generation after us. You have the verse on, just say amen. If you have the verse, just say amen. Okay, I heard two people. Thank you for your grace. You're so kind. Okay, Judges chapter 2, verses 6 to 15. We'll wait for everyone because this is very important. Heard two people. How about this side here? Judges chapter 2, 6 to 15. But I'm just going to focus on verse 10. And it says, after that whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what He had done for Israel. Let me read it again. After that whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what He had done for Israel. This is the Joshua generation. Remember Joshua? He said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But then the generation after him, after they all died, didn't know God. Our prayer is that our youth would run the race and take the baton. And then they will honor God, not hate God. And they will love God, not disobey Him. Our prayer is that we would see them growing in the Lord. They would fear God. They would have this heart for people, that they be saved as well. Not the youth who are wild. Not the youth who don't know God. Just like that generation right there in Judges. Now, friends and sisters and brothers, we have such a role to play. Please don't let the generation after you be wayward. Let's not let this happen to the youth. Let's help them so that we can say, perhaps years after us, that the next generation would read, after the whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, we, the new generation, are still serving God, loving God, honoring Him, growing in Him, serving Him with all of our hearts, and we shall do whatever God would have us to do, run the race, be strong, and pass on the baton of faith to another generation. That is what we are looking forward for. Amen. That's the generation, church, that we would like to see. Not the generation which is wayward, but that is through God's grace and through your cooperation. We all need each other in this whole thing. If you believe, just to say amen. Let's be Christians who run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the finisher of our faith. Can you give God a wonderful hand of praise in this place? God, we give you all the praise. We give you all the honor, the glory, and all of the praises, God, because you are good in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's just pray, Father. We thank you for the time that you've given to us. We thank you, Lord, for having us know you through the people that you have used so that we would come to know you and love you and honor you. God, we are praying for the generation after us today. We are praying, Lord, that they would know you and you would enable them to become the people that you would like them to be. We pray, Lord, that you would help us as well become good examples to them. That when they look at us, they see Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And God, we will continue becoming strong because you will make us strong, Lord God. And you, by your wisdom and by your spirit, we would know when to pass this baton of faith. And Lord, we would need your grace as well to sustain the new generation. And we will continue doing that until the day that you said, I'm coming and I'm here. Until the day you've come again. Thank you, Lord, for you are good. We bless you, honor you, bring you all the glory. And all the people of God say, amen.